Good morning to everyone out there on YouTube, except for the people that are still out on spring break down in Florida partying. It is Monday morning, so we are going behind the business of fantasy football, and this is a special episode. I know I feel like I say that every time, but there's two reasons why. One, we got the legend Adam Levitan onto the show. I don't know how he pulled it. I don't even think he knows what's going on right now, but I'm really excited for this one to interview him. Two, this is the last piece of content, I believe, ever being created in the Brooklyn headquarters. The business of fantasy football. We're talking marketing, advertising, sponsors, social engagement, all that stuff. Adam is the co-founder of Establish the Run, has a huge presence in the fantasy football industry. Of course, I'm sure all you guys are familiar with the brand, with the company, and what Adam has done over the years, you know, between DraftKings and between Roto World and all the places that he's kind of stopped along the way. Adam, I'm super, super, super duper excited to have you. When I started the series 2 years ago, I think this is the 23rd episode, I want to say, you were pretty much, I think I had like three people in mind that I really wanted to do for this. You were one of the three. You're such a down-to-earth dude. And I'm like, I feel like we can relate on a lot of levels, like personality-wise. So I was like, I want to interview him, but you've also had so much experience in the space. So I'm really excited to see like your takes on a lot of things. Kind of getting here with you is pretty surreal. So welcome to the business of fantasy football, and I'm super excited to chop it up for the next hour or so.
Yeah, thanks for having me, man. Yeah, I love this stuff. I love talking about it. I love thinking about it. I think I ran super hot and got super lucky with a lot of stuff that we can talk about if you want. But yeah, I mean, happy to be here. Arms are looking good, by the way. I see you posted that thing about doing the push-ups and the squats and the and the crunches, dude. Looking big.
Yeah, I hate that was your first impression of me. Now I feel like an asshole. But I appreciate it. Listen, man, we got to stay fit. I just actually hid my yoga mat that I have on the other side of the room over there because we're locked up, man. Like you said, you can't play basketball. Yeah. We can't go to the gym. We got to keep each other accountable somehow. Otherwise, over the next month and a half, we're all going to be, you know, a little thick. We're going to be on the Eddie Lacy level. But yeah. No more football talk. No players. No. If you're here for fantasy football content, I'm sorry. This is not the place to be. We're going to talk some business. So, Adam, you go back in the industry, right? You have a lot of experience over a lot of different places. And in terms of like your first official place, I could be wrong on this, but I want to say you started at Roto World in 2005. I'm assuming that wasn't, you know, you don't just, you know, wake up one day, open your laptop and are working for Roto World. So give us a little bit of a background history of like how you got to that point or what you were doing before then, whether it was starting in college and doing your own blog or whatever, you know, the floor is yours there.
Yeah, no, I graduated from Penn State in 2004, so I'm super old. Graduated from Penn State in 2004, and I got this job at a place called the Sports Network, like maybe 2 or 3 months after I graduated, and it was in the suburbs of Philadelphia, and it was like a borderline real job. They paid me like $25,000 a year. I was like covering like European soccer, quote unquote covering. We would watch the games on TV and then like write about them for this website that was kind of like a wire service. And they laid me off after like 5 or 6 months because, well, for a lot of reasons, but you know, they just weren't doing that well. And so they cut all the people that they had recently hired. So after that, I was doing a lot of stuff that I talked about in the podcast, mostly like playing poker for a living and also doing things, part-time work for small newspapers like the Doylestown Intelligencer as a page designer, and got to know this guy, Jordan Ronan, who now covers the Giants for ESPN. He got the job as the sports editor at Metro Philadelphia, which was like a free daily that like homeless people used to like sleep on, and people do like the crossword puzzling and stuff like that. If you guys are in Philly or New York or Boston, you probably know it. And so he gave me a chance to write some Sixer stuff, some fantasy stuff. And so yeah, after like a couple of years of doing that and grinding poker a lot, I just sent some of these fantasy clips to Greg Rosenthal, who was like the head of Roto World football at the time. Now he's with NFL Network. And after like 6 months, Greg wrote me back just out of the stone blue and was like, I can't let you write any articles. You know, maybe that can come later. I need news blurbers. So I started off doing part-time, you know, like $8 an hour news blurbers.
Is that what you guys call each other? Blurbers?
Yeah, blurbers. Exactly.
That's funny.
So I think I started that in like 2007 or 2008. And yeah, so that's how I got to Roto World. I met Evan there and Pat and Wessling and all those guys. And that's kind of how it got started. And then fantasy football just started to take off in Roto World. I think Roto World was extremely popular because it was just like straight news, which people needed. And at the time, it was really hard to find that straight news. And we spent so much time reading newspapers. It wasn't like when there was Twitter and all the news comes to you. Like we actually, I used to wake up in the morning and read 32 newspapers every single morning. There's sports sections on the internet just to try to find you know, an injury report or who was healthy or whatever. And so Roto World got really popular, and then that was obviously good for me. And then, yeah, everything kind of took off from there. I never thought that this would be like a full-time thing, and it might not have been. Maybe I'm speeding ahead too fast here, but I was really almost ready to give up because it just wasn't enough money, you know, for me to really like put a ton of time in and live the lifestyle I want to live. So I was almost ready to give up. And then DFS happened, and that was just like the exponential boom that like the industry needed to inflection of money.
You're almost known as like the DFS guy in fantasy. And that's not to be taken in a bad way or like put you in a box or anything, but you've grown so big to the point where now it's like when you think of DraftKings, you think of you, right? Is that weird for you?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, like people would say maybe like I mean, I've gambled, quote unquote gambled, you know, and I've talked a lot about this, what my definition of gambling is, but by most people's definition of gambled, I've gambled almost every day for the last, you know, 17 years or something. And season long, even what people would consider high stakes, you know, $1,000 buy-in or $2,000 buy-in or $5,000 buy-in. It's like for the amount of hours that you put in and your expectation in like a single season, you're not even playing that big. So DFS always like super, super, super appealed to me. I love fantasy football and I love peer-to-peer skill games, which I think DFS is. And so DFS was just like so, so, so perfect for me. And I think a lot of like the season long guys before me, like kind of were like, oh, this is going to be a fad, or this is not real fantasy football, or stuff like that. And yeah, I just thought that it was like perfect for me. So I don't mind being associated with DFS at all. Like that's like the only form of fantasy that I've played really for the last 5 years.
So let me ask you, do you enjoy actually playing DFS and like the gambling portion of it more than creating content around that stuff? Like if for the rest of your life, money didn't matter, and like from this day forward, you could be like, oh, you could just play DFS and grind it out and gamble and play poker or whatever, or create content around it. Like, which do you prefer more?
Yeah, no, I consider myself a player first. You know, I think that's what's like made whatever success I've had. People, you know, there's a lot of people that jump in and they try to be about DFS and they're not really players. They're just like trying to talk about it. I think actually playing and trying to play big and trying to play seriously is a big part of what is any success that I had in it. The thing is about it, like your ceiling is capped in playing, you know, like there's only one of me. I can only play so much poker. I can only play so much DFS. And as you get to high stakes, like it's tough, man. You know, like edges are, you know, 1%, 2%, 3%. And, you know, if you're good, maybe 5, 6% or something like that. And so people extrapolate that out. They realize that there's a lot more money to be made doing other things in life, investments, business, et cetera, than there is just straight playing. But from a fun perspective, I mean, God, playing is always the best.
Yeah. It's funny because most of my audience is season long. And I've been transitioning a lot of my content into Dynasty Fantasy. Do you play any Dynasty?
I'm in one league that RotoPat suckered me into. It's fun, man. It takes a lot of thought. I think it's fun.
So it's funny how you say like a lot of people jump into DFS and they just try to create and make something out of it, but they're not real players. I'm seeing that a lot in Dynasty too, around content being created within the space, because a lot of people are seeing that. It's getting, I mean, it's not that popular, but it's getting a lot more popular within the season-long audience. So a lot of people are jumping in. And they'll, you know, tweet things out or put up polls or whatever. And it's just like, if you're really in the day-to-day of the Dynasty stuff, you're just like, that's not a reasonable fucking poll to put out there. That's not a thing that like normal Dynasty players would really focus on. It's funny seeing how, you know, trends kind of take off and then people try to jump on. But I think, like you said, it goes back to, if you're not like a player first, your stuff is not really going to resonate with the other people that are players. And they're the ones that are ultimately decide how big you grow.
Exactly. People can spot if something's authentic or not. Like, people aren't dumb, you know, the overwhelming majority of people can spot it. So yeah, for sure.
Going off that point, you had your last solo pod episode you put out a couple days ago, just kind of saying goodbye to DraftKings. And that was the last piece that you will be putting on DraftKings, because the rest of the content will be 100% focused on Establish the Run. And I noticed something when you were talking throughout it, most of the stuff you said, you thank the people at DraftKings and the people that have helped you so far and whatever. And most of it didn't really touch on DFS or gambling or fantasy or whatever. It was all those like behind the scenes things that you really enjoyed. You're like, the funnest part were fan questions that I got at the end, those kind of things that I got to write up in the book and that kind of stuff. And it's funny because like you've grown very big. And the way I look at it, because I've been following you for a long, long time, and I have friends that like have followed you for, you know, 10 years, like a decade, right? You've always been that guy that's like very down to earth and very relatable. And I feel like, I don't know if you know this, but I feel like the reason that you grew to where you are today, that wasn't like a piece of it. I feel like that was because of that stuff. Because in today, like the way I look at branding and the way I look at kind of separating yourself is, it's almost like trying to get into a new social media platform, like if you're not first to market, it's going to be very hard to get there. I almost feel like authenticity is at that point where it's like, if that's not already a key piece of the content that you're putting out, you're like way behind the trend. So you were one of the first dudes, I feel like, that really kind of threw their personality and their authenticity into the content that they were creating. When you did that, like when you started integrating that stuff into your content, was that just like intentional, or was that just like, this, I can't do it any other way?
Yeah, I find football like kind of boring.
Like a super long-winded question that kind of threw
I find like, you know, football kind of boring, you know? Like if I wasn't playing fantasy, like I would never watch football. I don't even know if at this point in my life, you know, I'd even watch sports anymore if it wasn't for fantasy. So, so I'm always think that finding other things to talk about is fun, but I think that like the way that what it takes to win at DFS or poker or anything else, the way you would think about it is the way that I like to think about life decisions also. So that's kind of where it came from. You know, people were asking me all kinds of questions about their life, and I would answer it in the same way I would think about a poker hand or a decision in DFS, and try to really get as much information as possible, make the best decisions possible. And I think people hadn't like thought like that, or they hadn't seen somebody like think like that before. Everybody I know in poker and everybody I know in DFS, I mean, every life decision is the same as you would make in gambling. So yeah, I thought it was like normal, but I guess on a larger scale, which I was lucky enough to have, like people just hadn't heard that before. And yeah, I love trying to be funny and trying to give exaggerated takes and stuff like that, because it's just fun.
Yeah, I hear you. All right. You've been through the rigors of it. You've done the blogging, you've done some video, done podcasting for a long time. What would you say is your favorite type of content to make?
Yeah, to make is definitely the podcast. I mean, I did some TV/video stuff when I was at RotoWorld/NBC. I've done, you know, some video stuff for DraftKings. It's just kind of uncomfortable for me to be up there with like a bunch of good looking people. And like, you know, like it's just, I just feel like I can't really be myself, you know, wearing a suit and stuff. So the podcast, you know, nobody sees me. I'm free to say whatever I want, and you can express yourself, I think, faster. You know, writing an article can take, I do spend a lot of time preparing for the podcast, maybe 3, 4, 5 hours for a solo pod or something like that. But writing an article, you know, can take way, 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 way longer than that. So yeah, I think from an efficiency standpoint, podcasting is also the best, I would say.
Yeah, it's definitely easier than video. I like video though. I feel like a super underrated part of like putting content out, and you do get this a little bit in podcasting, but in video, I feel like even just like hand gestures like this and like little micro expressions, I feel like are very relatable to the audience. I don't know. That's just something I've kind of thought about recently over the last year or so. I'm like, yeah, I really like video for that reason. And I feel like when you do video, people get sort of an attachment to you like very, very quickly. But you do get that with podcasting as well, which is why obviously we've seen it blow up so recently.
It's funny. At NBC, they had an actual person who's, it was like an on-air coach. And so one time they sent me to like meet with this on-air coach, and it was this girl, and she was like, okay. And like she put up like the tape, like we were studying like film of a football game. And she was like, your hands need to be like crossed like this. And when you talk, you need to have your left hand here and your right hand here. And I was like, oh my God, like, what am I doing?
And if that was your first impression of it, yeah, I guess I would probably hate video too. That's awful. We talked about how your DraftKings era has come to an end. I want to talk about the relationship you had with DraftKings a little bit. As we talked pre-show with Pat Mayo, who was the last guest on here, he has his show, The Pat Mayo Experience. Now he gets a lot of listens through his podcast audio. So when he gets to talk about content creation, whether it's talking to advertisers or sponsors or potential, you know, buyers of the actual content itself, like DraftKings, he can kind of split that up. And that's exactly what he did. He sold the video content to DraftKings. So if you go on the DraftKings YouTube page, it's all the Pat Mayo Experience stuff, but he still owns the rights to his audio stuff. So for you, like I said, I wasn't really sure about your relationship with DraftKings. You said DFS kind of got popular. You started doing a lot of content for them. I'm just curious, a little peek behind the curtain, like how did that get started, your partnership with them? And like, what was it like throughout the landscape of it? And just like the details behind it.
Yeah, so I was at RotoWorld, but I was getting super into DFS, and you know, I was friends with Peter and Al from doing a show with them. Peter had just started Fantasy Labs, and so we were talking about what could happen if I left RotoWorld. And so him and Al and, you know, the guys at DraftKings reached out to me and did an independent contractor agreement with them, basically to be like a brand ambassador, do a podcast, and and write some articles. It was very loose, you know, at that time. And this was 2015, before like everything happened with DFS. This was like during the Wild West times. Like, they were not too worried about little old me. So it wasn't anything too serious. It was just, you know, come on, be a brand ambassador, promote DraftKings and do the podcast and write some articles. And that was basically it. And then at the same time, I did a deal with Fantasy Labs to help promote the Fantasy Labs product and do the news for them too, in the same kind of way that I had done it for Roto World before. And so, yeah, that was kind of the way it was for all 5 years at DraftKings. I talked about such absurd things on the podcast and on Twitter, and they never like batted an eye, you know. And I even like talked about things like, it's one thing to be funny and joke about like sex and stuff like that, which I did a ton. But also, I also talked to people seriously about like how hard it is to win and rate, being rate conscious and stuff that like most operators wouldn't want you to talk about. And DraftKings never, ever, outside of like a couple rare occasions, like the Bachelor Gate thing and the Ethan Gate thing, outside of those times, they never, not once, asked me not to talk about XYZ topic.
That's cool though. I feel like that works really well from a company standpoint, even though, you know, on the contrary, where you're like, it might be weird for them to let you do that. I think in the long run, it helps a brand like that. It kind of gains trust with the audience when you actually hear them open up about what they're doing and things they have going on behind the scenes. An audience member hears that and they're like, oh, that is pretty cool. Maybe I could put a little more trust into this brand. And that might be the switch between, you know, a FanDuel or DraftKings or whatever it is. So you were talking about being a brand ambassador. You're spoken like a true millennial Instagram girl over there. I know you're.
Oh, really? Is that what they say? God.
Basically, like every hot girl that has over 3,000 followers is a brand ambassador for some kind of like clothing, bathing suit line or like clothing brand or some shit like that, like Fashion Nova. So when I hear the word brand ambassador, it's funny coming out of your mouth, because I know you're not really, into that whole scene. You don't have an Instagram, right?
I don't, but maybe I should, considering all these brand ambassador opportunities.
Like, you're the real brand ambassador over here. Get on there and show them what's going on. Yeah, it's funny because I make the overlay for this video. Like, I'll take the Zoom video and I'll throw it into the video editing software or whatever. And there's an overlay where, like, we're transparent. But on the bottom, I'll usually put, like, your Twitter handle. And then most people have an Instagram, so I put, like, their Instagram thing. But I was like, damn, I don't think Adam has one. I'm pretty sure, like, he's like, very much against that. So it's funny that you don't have it, just because, like, I'm 27 years old. So if I come across, you know, if I meet new people that are my age, like 25 years old, and they're like, I don't have an Instagram, I'm like, that's fucking weird, bro. Like, why don't you have an Instagram, you know? So it's kind of funny because I heard you like talk about stuff like this. But let's get to the juicy shit. Establish the Run. You co-founded Establish the Run, and this was kind of like the news heard around the industry, because yourself, as well as the guys like Evan Silva and the team that you've put together, are, in a sense, you guys are the biggest influencers in the space. You guys are the biggest brand ambassadors for fantasy football. So I want to go back to when it all kind of started. And in your solo pod, you talked about the last one you just put out. You're like, I don't want to have any regrets looking back and saying I didn't put everything I had into Establish the Run. So this is a year later, a year and a half after it's actually launched. When did it launch again?
We announced in July of, right before last season. So July of 2019.
Okay, so it's coming on a year in a little bit.
Yeah.
So I'm sure the discussions about launching happened far, 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 far before July happened, because there's so much that goes on behind the scenes. Take me back to maybe the idea of it coming to fruition. Who had like the first thought about it being a thing? Who reached out to who? What was the first conversation, phone call? Who was on it? Like, give me some of that.
Yeah. You know, I always thought that at a big company like NBC, like, the workers don't realize the upside, right? Like, you realize your floor a lot at a big company, you know, like, they're going to pay you a certain amount, and no matter what happens, coronavirus breakout or sports ends or whatever, like, you're going to get your salary. But from an upside perspective, from a ceiling perspective, like, you just don't realize it when you're just one of the worker bees, when you're just like one of the peons at a big company. And so there's pros and cons to it. For sure, I always thought that it was right to try to own your upside, and so to bet on yourself. So I've always been trying to convince Evan to do something for, I don't know, probably going back to 2015. I had a lot of different ideas. One idea was just to do a premium podcast where on Friday night, we would just go game by game, and that's it. We wouldn't have a website. We wouldn't have anything. We would just charge like $100 for the season just to talk on Friday night and go game by game. And maybe that would have been successful, but if we were also getting mine and Evan's takes throughout the whole week, I don't think it would have worked, number one. And number two, like, it's not a real business just to have like a podcast. It's not like a full blown business. So I had plenty of ideas and discussions about that. The timing wasn't always right, but Yeah, the idea to do it, Taylor Cabey, who I think is like one of the smartest people in gambling and is, you know, not just playing, but on the business side. And I don't know, I did an interview with Taylor, if you guys don't know much about him, on the Establish and Run feed. You can find out more about him. And I've known Andrew Wiggins really well over the last few years just from playing. And he worked with DraftKings for a little bit, and also one of the best people that I know in gambling. So I thought it was the best possible team from both content and branding and business. And I thought that it would be like our floor was, you know, okay, so we only, you know, it doesn't work out and we go back and we work for NBC or whatever, you know, it's not the end of the world. So it seemed pretty obvious, at least to me, that it was well worth it just to take a shot and just try to do it. So yeah, I mean, that's basically it. It wasn't something overly complicated. It's just we worked a long time, Evan and I did, to build up a following. And so obviously somebody who doesn't have a following can't just haul off and start a business and try to be profitable in year one. Like, it's not going to work like that. I feel like we've been working towards this for the last 10 years. And so it's a little bit different for us than I think other people that are thinking about starting a business. But, you know, we had like 10 years behind it, which I thought made a big difference too.
Yeah. Was there like a specific text that you got from Evan that was finally like, all right, fuck it, let's do it?
Kind of. I mean, God, we were going back and forth for so long. Yeah, because I understand, like, you know, there's certainly a lot of risks about it. I can't remember one specific text, but yeah, we were just talking about it for months, I'd say.
I've brought this up on this series before. We've brought up Establish a Run. I've always said that I was surprised it took Evan this long. I didn't know you were like into the whole business side of things. I've had Evan on one of our podcasts before. I was surprised because you guys built so much leverage by yourselves. Like, the audiences that you guys have are worth more than, you know, staying where you guys are, because you can monetize that so easily, whatever you bring towards the new brand that you have. And we got Evan onto one of the podcasts I do with two of my friends, and I started asking him some of these questions, right? Because this was probably after I'd done like 8 or 10 of these interviews, and Evan was one of the guys I wanted to have on. And I started asking him most of the business questions that I was curious about at the time. And Evan was just like, yeah, I don't really do anything like business related. He's like straight up the content guy. Like, when we talk about like being in the life, man, he is like really about knowing every beat reporter and everything that happens. I'm like, Jesus Christ, this guy is like crazy within football. And I like really respect the passion and the grind he has for it. So it seems like you're a little bit more on the passionate side when it comes to business things.
Yeah. And that's why I thought it worked perfectly. I mean, Evan knows more about football. I respect Evan's opinion about football more than anybody on the planet, more than, you know, people on NFL teams and reporters and all that. I think he has like a really, really unique way of analyzing football and what's going to happen. So yeah, I think it's better. I mean, God, he's like a crazy encyclopedia of football and understands what's going on. And he's like doing blurbs right now on free agency in his tracker thing on like offensive linemen, and like offensive lineman signs like a 1 year, $3 million deal. And he knows like everything about this guy. So yeah. And that's not me for sure, because a lot of that stuff I think is more football than winning in DFS. I think it all goes towards it, but, you know, like the actual, like down to the bottom minutia is more just about football. And he absolutely loves football.
Yeah. It's so funny. It's so evident once you talk to him for like, I don't know him that well, and he probably doesn't really remember who I am, but I could tell within like 10 minutes of the conversation, I was like, this guy's not a bad way, but he's fucking crazy. Like, that's the way Evan is, you know? So you bring on guys that obviously know business well, like you said, and they run the company very well. How involved are you individually when it comes to, you know, business decisions within Establish the Run?
Yeah, everything, every day. Yeah, I'm trying to learn more and not be a total noob about business. It's crazy. People don't realize how many decisions there are every day and how many strategy sessions. And you put up a website, you put up some articles and some shows, and that's it. There's been an insane amount that goes on behind the scenes. And yeah, I'm involved in all of it. I find it super fascinating. And I want to have, I mean, the whole point of this is that like we have control over it, and we make the decisions that we think are right, not what, you know, some, you know, CEO who went to Harvard Business School thinks is right. Like, we actually know the space and we think is right.
I was gonna say, you have, like, as a person, you have a great feel for what's going on. Like, you interact with your audience and shit. So there's no one, like, you could be as good as you can be at business, like you said, coming out of Harvard or whatever, but like, you ultimately, even if you've never ran a business before, can make those decisions 100 times better than anyone who has no idea what's going on within the fantasy space. So you said, you know, you're trying to learn and you're getting more and more into the whole business thing, like day by day, there's so many decisions. Going into it, did you actually think that it was going to be, obviously you didn't, you're not this naive to think it was just really just setting up the website, putting out content and things, but like compared to how crazy it is, how much more work have you been investing into it than you originally thought it would be? Or like, what are some of the biggest obstacles that have like come up that you didn't think were going to be a thing when you started?
Yeah, tech for number one. I mean, it's hard to scale without an understanding of the tech side and getting people who can do the tech side really well. So that's been eye-opening. I think there's a ton of contractual and legal stuff about having a company and lawyering that goes on that I wasn't aware of. I think if you're only in it for the short term, you know, you want to start a business and try to print something off for a year or two, then a lot of this long-term stuff, like, it doesn't matter how well your business is set up or your tech side or whatever. I think if you're trying to build something long-term, then all this business stuff comes way more into play and we're trying to build something big for the long-term. So yeah, I think short-term, maybe I could have done it myself. Long-term, having a real business plan and actual strategies and partnerships and stuff like that is for sure necessary.
When you mean tech, are you referring to like web development? I know a thing for you guys that was a little bit of an issue early on was trying to get the Established to Run, the paid podcast out mm-hmm. to subscribers on the iTunes channel. I don't even want to know how difficult that would be because I'm like familiar with a lot of the things that you're bringing up. But when it comes to like, in order to do that shit, you like really need to know what you're doing behind the scenes when it comes to coding and stuff. Are those the things you're referring to when you mean tech?
Yeah, I mean, just every little thing. Yeah. Oh, the subscribers should have, they want the podcast on iTunes. That makes sense. How do we do that? And the next thing I know, it's like a 20-hour project for a developer. You know what I mean? I just had no idea. I thought it would just be like, you know, snap your fingers, but I didn't think every little thing that you wanted to do on the website would be such a process. So yeah. And, you know, we had server issues at the beginning. You know, we had all kinds of issues. You know, Adam Schefter like retweeted one of Evan's tweets at the beginning and just completely crashed the site. And one of the Sunday shows, like the site crashed. Too many people were trying to log in at once because like the login people weren't caching their login. You know, like a million things like that. And so it just is what it is. I wish that I knew more about tech, but at this point, I feel like that ship has kind of sailed on me, even though maybe it shouldn't, but I feel like the ship has kind of sailed on me on coding and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, the time you'd have to take to learn it is probably not worth that time that you'd put elsewhere. Yeah. All right, so I do want to ask about, because you guys sell a product, which is your content, and you sell it at a very, very premium price within the industry. I want to talk through the decision that made you want to put it at this price point. Because this is like a very, when you had brought up like me and Evan doing this, like, oh, you know, there's risks there. The way I looked at it, like the following that you guys had built, the audiences, the branding, and like just the loyalty from those people that you built, there's no way that it could fail, at least in the short term, right? 3 to 5 years, because you guys have built such a cushion for what you have already, you know, made within the space. But when it comes to this premium price point, like this was something that me as like an outsider and people out there are like, wow, this is, you know, somewhat risky because you will be cutting off a huge portion of your audience from purchasing the subscription at it's $200, right? It was for the first season.
Correct. Yep.
So $200 price point. And that's one of the more expensive pieces for, I think a lot of the audience was, correct me if I'm wrong, but a lot of it was season long, at least a pretty good portion of it.
Yeah. It's hard to say how many, what percentage. I think people underestimate the overlap between season-long players and DFS players. But yeah, it's hard to say how many of them were actually just season-long players.
Yeah, the only reason I asked that question is because I think there's a different, you know, you could kind of waver between price points when you're talking about DFS versus season-long. The typical season-long fan will probably spend about $30 tops on something that they think is a really good piece of content that will help them mm-hmm. either draft or throughout the season. Where DFS, there are people that are gambling $20,000 a weekend, so they have no problem dropping $200 on a product like yours. But coming from like Evan Silva's a big season long guy, you're a big DFS yeah. guy, you guys have built a brand around having followings all over the spaces. So with that price point, were you guys just like, we are the creme de la creme, like we are the best in fantasy football, so we are going to be charging that much and people are going to pay it because they want our content? Is it that simple?
It was a super hard decision. I mean, pricing is really hard. You can do projections and math. Obviously, we know that there's a lot of season long people that, you know, we love and that aren't going to pay. They're not going to get to read Evan's column. We did offer a package for Evan's column only, I forget how much that was, but it was cheaper. It wasn't cheap, but it was cheaper. And so we thought that that would be good maybe for some of the people who just wanted to read Evan's column. I think a lot, you can always make things cheaper. You can always do sales. You can always run promos. You can't really make stuff more expensive midway through the season or whatever, you know? And so I thought that it was right to err on the side of expensive. I thought one thing that like Poker Go is like a subscription for people that watch poker, and they charge like something relatively cheap, like $10 a month. I don't know how many subscribers they have, but like the people that are willing to pay to watch poker streams are willing to pay a lot more, you know? So like the people that are actually willing to buy it are willing to pay a lot more, and you're not really losing that many people. So I don't know. There's a lot that goes into it. I always would want to err on the side of charging what we think it's worth, and we think it's worth a lot. And especially for DFS players, which, you know, I think make up a large portion probably of the subscribers. For the draft kits, certainly there were, you know, so many season-long people that wanted Evan's rankings and all the team previews and stuff like that. But for the in-season package, yeah, I mean, $200 in the DFS world, as you mentioned, is pretty cheap.
It brings it to an interesting point, because $200 is a high price point for a lot of people. But one thing I've learned is, you know, before I was doing this stuff full time, I was a freelance like marketer. I was working at an agency in New York, and I was running paid social campaigns like Facebook and Instagram. So like the sponsored posts you see on the news feed. Eventually left the job, and I was doing it on my own. I'd work with like smaller, medium sized businesses, and I had no fucking idea how to price, right? Like it was the first time I went on my own, and I was maybe like 24 at the time or something. So sending over a contract, even asking them for like an eighth of what they would be paying a normal agency for, felt like really nerve wracking. I was like, they're not going to want to pay me. They're not going to want to pay a kid. Even though I was confident in what I was doing and I knew how to like run the campaign successfully, but I've learned really quickly that like people have money and people are willing to pay for things that they want. You know what I mean? Like whether it's $100, $200, yes, they'll pay for it. And like you said, like you can't go up in the price. But one thing that I sell a draft guide throughout the summer for the season long audience, and legit, like if I bought concert tickets last summer, one point, it was like the end of July or something. And I was just like, fuck it. Like they were kind of expensive. I bought 4 tickets. I was like, you know what? I want to like reimburse these tickets. So I just sent out an email to my email list. I was like, yo, draft guide's on sale for like 50% off for the next like 10 minutes or whatever. And that shit just like shot right up. And I was like, yo, it's crazy how well these sales really work. Throwing in like different tactics like that works so well. And it's not really something that you think about because your email is like consistently flooded with like, oh, 10% off sale, 25% off sale. I'm curious, like from your guys' point of view, obviously you ran some of that stuff throughout the summer and throughout the year. Going into next year, I'm sure you've learned so much about your audience and so much from the industry itself from a business perspective. How are you looking at planning for like the upcoming year in terms of, you know, bringing on new customers and trying to hold on to the customers that you already have?
Yeah, we're trying to add more quantitative. I think we have the qualitative stuff down with Evan mostly and me. I think there is a lot of room to be more data driven when it comes to projecting players. So yeah, we posted a job a couple weeks ago for director of analytics, and right, we expect to hire somebody there soon that can give us more of a, hey, I know you guys love X guy. Let me explain what needs to happen for X guy statistically, mathematically, what needs to happen for X guy to actually do what you're saying. And so I think that kind of back and forth can be really good and really valuable to have the best of both qualitative and quantitative. So I think adding stuff like that, I think will be really, really, I think really, really valuable for people. But yeah, you know, I think the feedback that we got, most people were happy with the product, and yeah, we just need sports to happen now. That's all.
All right. So you guys are going to be adding more, not content creators in a sense, but how many people you have working full time for ETR right now?
Full-time, just the 4 founders right now.
Okay. And the rest of the people are pretty much just, are they like part-time? Are they freelance? Are they just like contributors to, are they just like excited to attach their name to your stuff?
Yeah, no, everybody's paid and everybody is all the freelancers. I think it's pretty standard in fantasy football. You know, people write on a per article basis or, you know, an hourly basis and stuff like that. I think most of the guys have regular jobs. They just do this on the side because, you know, they love it and they want to make some extra money, and a lot of them are really, really good, but I think that's pretty standard.
Yeah. Okay. I was curious as to, you kind of touched on it in terms of like what you plan to include in this upcoming year, and you have the smart business people behind you that probably think about these numbers and stuff. Are you guys concerned at all about the churn rate of your customers, given that it's a high price point? Or are you based on the feedback, you're saying that they seem pleased with the product and you're not really too concerned with it?
Yeah, I mean, we don't have any much data on that yet, but yeah, I'm not worried about it. I think we just need to do what we do. And we know that people love it. They've loved it for the last 10 years. And I think if we concentrate on doing what we do and keep making it better, that it's going to work out okay. But yeah, I don't know. Talk to me in 3 to 5 years.
Yeah, I'm sure I'll have you back on the show. So with the content you guys are putting out, what percentage of it, how much of it is behind a paywall versus how much of it is free throughout the off season and season? It kind of switches up, right?
Yeah. And that's been a debate too. We want to make as much stuff as free as possible so that, you know, we just want people who can't afford to still get to read us and stuff like that. And we want to get our stuff out there so people can see it. At the same time, I don't want people who actually paid to feel like, why are they giving this stuff away for free? So it's a hard balance. So during the season, anything DFS related, anything that we think you can use to win is behind the paywall. So that's most of it during the season, almost all of it during the season. In the off season, we have everything is free right now on the site. So, you know, Evan's top 150 and dynasty rankings and all the free agency stuff and all the podcasts are free. I think the podcast, you know, is being free and doing a lot of them is really good. You know, people get to know us. And yeah, I think that's probably our best free thing that will stay free all year round. Even during the season, we were doing one free podcast a week just to have people get gain some access and let them know what we're up to.
Yeah, it's a very fine line to walk there between, you know, how much you want to put in front, how much you want to put behind. Because if you start putting too much behind the paywall, then, you know, you're going to start losing any kind of growth that you have, because people can't, you know, they can't find you and they're never going to connect with you that way. So right. I'm sure there's been some interesting debates behind the walls of ETR on that kind of stuff. Usually we end these interviews with some random questions that I feel like you might have some good answers for. Best purchase you've made under $100.
Yeah. Best purchase I made under $100. I have this portable phone charger. It's like a brick that I got. And I didn't think I'd use it that much. It's literally the best thing on earth. I charge it and it gives me like 4 charges into my phone. So once you charge the brick, you can carry it around. I just put it in my bag. And anytime I need my phone charged, I just put it in there. It's amazing. I also still use, everybody's gonna laugh at me, you guys probably don't even know what it is. Something called a TI-82 calculator, which is like, I think it's like $60 or something.
I have my TI-83 right on the table over there.
83 is a good version. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
83 is a good version. Yeah, I like, for whatever reason, I like being able to see when I'm doing like any type of math problem. I like being able to see what I put in instead of it just like disappearing. And then I have to keep looking and figure out where the error was. So I love my TI-82.
Bro, I love that call, because I use that when I'm doing my research all the time. And anytime, like, I'll accidentally leave it in like maybe the corner of my table for one of my videos or something, and people always fucking call it out and shit on it. I'm like, this is the best purchase. That actually might be my answer. I'm really fucking excited you said that. All right, so you've done a lot of things outside of fantasy sports. You wrote the book, or at least the ebook, gambling and these kind of things. I'm curious, like, now that you are a business owner, like over the next maybe 3 to 5 years, 10 years, maybe down the line, is there some kind of like creative endeavor outside of anything that you've done up to this point that you could see yourself pursuing?
Yeah, you know, I wish I had developed more interest. My interests for so long have been peer-to-peer games. You know, I think that there's room, and we tried it with the Gambling Olympics with Action Network. There's room for stuff like that, where we thought it'd be really cool and people would actually really like to watch us all rent a house and just gamble against each other for a few days and see who comes out on top. I think that's super interesting. I think we could do better on the format, which we learned a lot about. But yeah, that was cool. I wish I had something for you that was better interest, like that frying pan tennis match that I played, where I played Steve Bass. He had a frying pan and I had my racket. Stuff like that is so fun.
So like more lifestyle stuff, basically.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, yeah, I've done so many of those fitness bets. I did that bench press bet against Peter, and me and Bales have run like three or either 2 or 3 mile races against each other now. Yeah, all that stuff is, people love it. And I love it. Yeah, it's the best.
I mean, Barstool has basically built their entire brand based on shit like that. I think our industry needs way more stuff like that. It's a reason I put out vlogs all the time. Like, I love shooting the behind the scenes shit that's going on, mm-hmm. you know, in my life and stuff. And I feel like it connects you with the audience on a whole nother level, right? It brings in people and they connect with you and shit that they've never seen. Like, if you guys made a vlog, like at the, do you guys all work remotely?
Yes.
Are you ever, how often are you together physically?
The ETR crew?
Yeah.
Yeah, since we started, we probably met up maybe 3 times.
You guys should vlog the next time you guys meet up.
Yeah.
Not even kidding. I know vlog is probably like something you're like, fucking brand ambassador alert is going off in your mind right now. I'm telling you, the people in your audience would absolutely love that shit.
I agree. But we got to hire somebody to like follow us with a camera, you mean?
You could do that. I mean, I fuck around with the camera all the time. I have a couple cameras that I'll follow around with like me and my friends and stuff. I think like there's definitely a fine line between doing it yourself and having someone follow you around. That's probably to like another level, which I would actually love to do, to be honest with you, only because I hate handling the camera. It's super annoying. But yeah, I mean, it's either have Evan handle the camera. I'm sure he's very skilled behind it. No. Okay. So more lifestyle stuff. Yeah. I feel like that's a very good answer. I love that stuff too. So best purchase on under $100. We have creative endeavors. We want one bold prediction. One very bold prediction for the future of the fantasy football industry as a whole.
I don't know how bold it is, but I think we're going to see like a melding of sports betting and fantasy. Instead of a DFS tournament where you pick players, you could have teams and you could assign salaries to, you know, if Patriots -7 cost $5,000 and you try to make teams that way. And so I think, you know, DraftKings and FanDuel will and should continue to innovate on the sports betting side to bring in what has made DFS and fantasy so successful on the season long side, you know, playing against your friends and stuff like that. And on the DFS side, you know, people just love trying to turn a little money into a lot. So yeah, I think there's room for like so much innovation on combining sports betting and fantasy football, if that makes any sense.
No, it makes tons of sense. I think like the whole betting side of things is going to eventually take over the sport itself. So the first platforms that figure out how to successfully integrate it with the audiences that they already have there for fantasy football and DFS or whatever are the ones that are probably going to win. So there's really no choice, you know, it's coming. So that makes a lot of sense. I think all three of them kind of bring their own unique audience to the table in a sense, because season long are people that are like semi-passionate, people that are into DFS. What percentage of people that play DFS you think are like really into it? You know, like not just like, okay, oh, you know, I have $5 on my account from 6 weeks ago, let me just build a random lineup.
Yeah. It's tough to say. I mean, I know how many people are listening to the podcast. And so I assume all those people are actually like trying really hard. And so, you know, it's varied a lot, but I don't know. I mean, there's so many people on DraftKings that only play football, that only play tournaments, that only play the Millie Maker. You know, that's probably a huge portion of the field. The people that we interact with on Twitter, feels like it's everybody, but it's actually a small portion of the field.
It is everybody, Adam. It is everybody. No one else.
Yeah. The thing about it is, though, it's aspirational, right? I think people don't, like, a lot of this stuff is so, like, people want to, with poker, with DFS, with sports betting, it's so aspirational. Like, even if they only go on their phone and play $5, they still might want to listen to somebody or talk with somebody who is trying really hard or has 5 figures in play and stuff like that. Like, they actually want to hear that stuff and they connect with it still, you know? Like, Doug Polk has like the biggest YouTube channel. I know he's not doing poker anymore, but like all the people listening to Doug Polk, they're not all playing poker, and most of them probably can't. And a lot of them are playing probably like $1, $2, whatever. It's super aspirational. So yeah, I think there's a lot of those people too that are consuming content.
Yeah. I mean, they're all over the place, and eventually Vegas is going to find a way to take their money. I have no doubt in that. All right. So that is, I believe that's going to wrap up this episode of Behind the Business of Fantasy Football with Mr. Adam Leviton, his Twitter. I might just make you an Instagram just to link it down there, and then you'll have to use it afterwards. Twitter and the Established Run podcast will be right below his video the entire time. The rest of the stuff that we have talked about throughout the video will be linked in the description as well as pinned in the comments section. Make sure that if you enjoyed the video, you hit that thumbs up button. Adam, I want to send a sincere thank you your way for coming on. I really appreciate your time. You've been an inspiration to people like me, kind of coming up and continuing the grind after seeing you do it for so long. So thank you for joining. Thank you for doing what you do. So keep grinding away at ETR, and I'm looking forward to the 2020 season.
Appreciate it, man. Thanks for having me.